Pokemon moves are arguably the most important factors in determining the outcome of a battle, other than the Pokemon themselves. Depending on the four moves you choose to teach a Pokemon, you can assign it varying roles such as an all-out attacker, a setup sweeper, or a bulky wall. In this video, I will rank the top 101 moves in Pokemon based on how useful they are in battle. Before I start, I should explain my criteria for the rankings. The amount of Pokemon that get a certain move is not a factor, since I want to evaluate each move by its properties alone. Properties that can be considered when comparing moves include the typing, effects, base power, and accuracy of the move, along with how it interacts with other Pokemon's abilities and types as a whole. I'll evaluate each move in a 4-on-4 double battle setting, like in VGC, the official competitive format. I did my best to make the list comprehensible for everyone, though. Powerful moves will almost still be powerful regardless of the format that they're used in, so if I were to grade them based on single battles, or how good they would be in a playthrough, only about 20 to 25 moves would shift up and down the rankings to a considerable extent. Lastly, I'll assume that all moves work under Generation 9 mechanics, including dynamic speed, where speed stats update mid-turn rather than at the end. However, I will be ignoring generational gimmicks such as Z-moves, Dynamax, and the most recent one, Terastallization, which lets a Pokemon change its type. With all that said, it's time to rank some moves. Coming in at number 101 is Searing Shot, the first of Victini's two signature moves to land on the list. It has a base power of 100 to go along with an accuracy of 100%, and attacks all Pokemon on the field, including your own partner, unfortunately. Moves that target multiple Pokemon on the field are called spread attacks, and are generally very effective in doubles, though they're balanced by having their power cut by a quarter. In other words, when a spread move hits multiple targets, all targets are hit with 75% of the power that the move would have had against a single Pokemon. Searing Shot also has a 30% chance to burn any target it hits. A burn is one of the best status effects in the game, as it halves an inflicted Pokemon's attack and reduces its HP by 1/16 each turn. Lunar Blessing and Jungle Healing are the signature moves of Cresselia and Zarud, respectively. They heal both the user's and partner's HP by 25%, while also removing any status effects either Pokemon may have. While most legendary Pokemon have possessed powerful signature moves for years, Game Freak has gotten pretty crazy with these kinds of moves in recent times. In Generations 8 and 9, covering Sword and Shield through Scarlet and Violet, nearly every Pokemon has a signature ability, move, or both. A lot of these moves and abilities are strong, but balanced by extremely limited distribution. If you're most familiar with the earlier generations of Pokemon, you're going to be shocked with the absurdity of some of the moves later in the video. Earthquake is one of three moves from Generation 1 on this list. It's a 100-100 physical ground-type attack that hits all targets on the field, like Searing Shot a couple of slots ago. While Earthquake doesn't have any additional effects, Ground is one of the best offensive types in the game, hitting 5 types super effectively. It's also a little easier to bypass the issue of hitting your partner, since Ground-type immune Pokemon such as Flying-types and Pokemon with the ability Levitate are readily available. One of the strongest special Normal-type moves in the game is Boom Burst, with an insane base power of 140 and accuracy of 100%. It's pretty low in the list because it hits everything on the field like Earthquake and Searing Shot, making it tougher to use in doubles. Normal type moves also aren't the best, as they hit no type super effectively. Steel and Rock types resist them, while Ghost types are completely immune. Hitting 15 of the 18 types neutrally is still alright though. Palafin's Jet Punch is a new physical water type move introduced in Scarlet and Violet. It has a measly base power of 60, but it's a priority move, meaning it goes before most regular attacks. These moves can be incredibly useful in a battle, since they permit slower Pokemon to move first. Normally, priority attacks with no other conditions, like Aqua Jet, Mach Punch, and Ice Shard, only have base powers of 40 to balance out their powerful effect. Being 50% stronger, Jet Punch heavily outclasses these moves. Pollen Puff is a 90 base power, 100% accurate special move introduced in Sun and Moon. It's an attack when targeting an opponent, but a healing move when targeting your ally. It's a versatile move, but you'll more often than not be using it to heal 50% of your ally's HP because of how bad the bug type is offensively. Three types are weak to bug attacks, but a whopping 7 resist them. Bitter Blade, from Generation 9, is Cerulege's signature move. It's a fire-type physical 9100 attack that heals 50% of the damage dealt. That's the same healing effect as most healing attacks, such as Giga Drain and Drain Punch. However, those moves have a base power of only 75, balancing out their secondary effect. With a base power of 90 and a good offensive typing, Bitter Blade is the move that lands on the list. Galarian Moltres' signature attack is Fiery Wrath. It's a Dark-type 9100 special move that hits both foes, qualifying it as a spread move. Unlike the previous spread moves on this list, though, it only hits the opponent's side of the field. I'll call these kinds of spread moves dual target for the rest of the video. Fiery Wrath has a 20% chance to flinch each target, meaning if the user is the fastest Pokemon on the field, there's a 36% chance that at least one of the opponent's Pokemon will flinch and not move that turn. Flinches can ruin or delay an opponent's game plan, turning the tide of battle in your favor. The only bad part about Fiery Wrath is its relatively low base power of 90. Due to the spread 75% rule, it's technically just a 67.5 base power move against each foe. Next up is Photon Geyser, Necrozma's signature move. It's a 100-100 psychic type move with the ability to ignore abilities. It also chooses the user's higher attacking stat to calculate damage, meaning if you have a Pokemon with an attack stat that's just above its special attack stat, Photon Geyser will initially be a physical attack. However, if your Pokemon gets its attack dropped by something like the ability Intimidate, the attack will be a special attack. Most EV-trained competitive Pokemon have significantly differing special attack and attack stats though, meaning this move's second effect is usually irrelevant. Rounding out the bottom 10 is Hyper Drill, a 100-100 normal type physical attack. Its signature user is the Dunsparce, the evolved form of Dunsparce. Hyper Drill's effect is that it can ignore an opponent's protection move, which would normally protect it from all damaging attacks for the turn. It doesn't lift the effects of protection for the remainder of the turn though, which some moves actually do, like the 30 base power Feint. So in doubles, the Hyper Driller's partner would still be attacking into a protection move if it were to target the same Pokemon. The first pivot move on this list is Volt Switch. This is a 70 base power electric-type special attack that also lets you switch out, assuming you actually land the move. Pivoting moves appear less frequently in doubles than singles, but are still vital to creating board states where you can gain a huge advantage. The only problem with Volt Switch is that there is a type immune to this move, along with a few abilities, like Motor Drive, Lightning Rod, and Volt Absorb, so you won't always be able to switch out. Malignant Chain is the most recent move on the list, being released on January 11th, 2024, along with its user, the mythical Pokemon Petchorunt. It's a 100-100 special poison-type move that badly poisons the target 50% of the time. Bad poisoning is the status that the move Toxic inflicts. Standard poisoning causes an afflicted Pokemon to lose 1/8 of its HP each turn, while bad poisoning causes one to lose 1/16 on the first, but an extra 1/16 on each subsequent turn. So at the end of the fourth turn, it's losing a quarter of its HP. While this effect is really powerful, Poison is a pretty terrible offensive type, only hitting two types super effectively, while hitting four not very effectively in Steel for nothing at all. Unsurprisingly, Malignant Chain is the only Poison-type attacking move on the list. The second DLC of Gen 9, the Indigo Disc, introduced Paradox versions of the Johto Beasts and Swords of Justice, each of which has... you know the drill. Iron Boulder's Mighty Cleave is the same thing as Hyper Drill, except for being 5 base power weaker and Rock-type. Rock attacks hit 4 types super effectively, and 3 not very effectively, so a solid bit better than normal. For now I'll go to an older signature move, Shaymin's Seed Flare. It's a 120-85 single target move with a 40% chance of lowering the target's special defense by 2 stages. In other words, the first time this effect activates, the stat will be cut in half. The 85% accuracy is the main thing keeping the move down here. For single target attacks, accuracy is a little more important in doubles than singles, since your Pokemon will usually spend less turns on the field thanks to two opposing Pokemon having the ability to attack it. Grass is also not a great offensive typing, hitting 7 other types for resisted damage. Wood Hammer is a 120-100 physical grass type move. While it doesn't miss like Seed Flare, it cuts the user's HP by a third of the damage dealt to an opposing Pokemon. This means it can't be used too many times during the course of a battle. You always know what you're getting out of the move though, and will never really have to worry about missing. One of the best moves introduced in Omega Ruby and Alpha Sapphire was Origin Pulse, a move that every Kyogre has cursed at some point or the other. 110 base power, 85% accuracy, special, and a dual target move. It's one of the few great spammable water type moves, but is held back from being way higher on the list because of its mediocre accuracy, which can lead to some situations like this. The first dragon type move on the list is Komo's Clanging Scales. Like Origin Pulse, it's a dual target 110 BP special move. It is 100% accurate, but lowers the user's defense by one stage after each use. There are several powerful moves that lower the user's defense, special defense, or both, but these aren't actually much of a hindrance to the user since it can keep using the moves to deal consistent, heavy damage each time. Plus, if you really need to, you can switch out to reset the drops. At number 83, we have one of Zygarde's 83 signature attacks, Core Enforcer. It's basically the same thing as the previously mentioned Clanging Scales, but without the drawback of dropping the user's defense by one stage. It's also 10 base power weaker, but I'd still call it a better move overall. If I was ranking moves based on animation, this would definitely be in the top 5. Another one of Zygarde's signature moves is Thousand Waves. This is a dual target 90 base power ground type physical attack and has a pretty interesting effect. It traps both opponents in for the duration that the user is in battle. This effect doesn't work on flying types due to their immunity to the move itself, or ghost types due to their immunity against trapping effects. Trapping can be used to create some offensive pins, such as the extreme example of forcing a Groudon to stay in as you switch in your Kyogre, stopping the opponent from setting up the sun, and destroying Groudon in the rain. In 81st place, we have an Anomaly. This move was a bit confusing to rank since it's one of the very few moves that can only be used by a Pokemon possessing a certain ability. I'm talking about Morpeko's signature move, Aura Wheel. Aura Wheel is a 110-100 physical move that always raises the user's speed by one stage. However, it changes type based on the mode that Morpeko is in. In Full Belly mode, Aura Wheel is an electric type move, while in Hangry mode, it's a dark type move. Morpeko's ability, Hunger Switch, switches between these modes each turn. For the purposes of this video, I'm just gonna say that the move itself switches between electric and dark type. This makes it inconsistent, though always raising speed by one stage while dealing the damage of a 110 base power move is still kind of nuts. The next two moves are Sword Stance and Nasty Plot, which were introduced in Gen 1 and Gen 4, respectively. Sword Stance raises the user's attack by two stages, while Nasty Plot does the same to Special Attack. The first use of either usually implies that the corresponding stat has been doubled. These are two of the best setup moves in the game, and if used in the right situation, they can allow a Pokemon to potentially KO an opponent's entire team. I have Nasty Plot a little higher, since Intimidate, an ability which drops the opponent's attack by one stage, is relatively common. In other words, Special Attack drops are much harder to remove. I also think that Special Attacks are better than Physical Attacks as a whole, since they are less likely to make contact. While there are abilities that let contact moves shine, like Tough Claws and Unseen Fist, they can negatively trigger a whole slew of other abilities and move effects, as you'll find out later in the list. Number 78 is Trick Room, one of the premier forms of speed control in doubles. This move changes the dimensions of the battlefield for 5 turns, allowing the slowest mons on the field to move first. I'd say it's technically 4 turns since it almost always goes last due to its low priority bracket, and the turn it is used counts towards the 5 turns. Anyways, many Pokemon, such as Ursaluna or Calyrex Ice, have fantastic attacking power and bulk, but lack the speed to make use of those tools. Under normal circumstances, they'll always be taking damage before getting attacks off. If they appear under Trick Room, however, these Pokemon will move first, and can potentially KO opposing Pokemon with their powerful attacks, not taking much damage in the process. Up next is probably the best Fairy-type attacking move, Moonblast. It's got a base power of 95, an accuracy of 100, and a 30% chance to drop an opponent's special attack. For reference, other strong non-signature special moves like Ice Beam, Flamethrower, Thunderbolt, and Earth Power are 5 base power weaker, and only have a 10% chance for each of their secondary effects to activate. Also, Fairy is a good attacking type, hitting 3 types super effectively and 12 others neutrally. Dragon Dance is a move that raises the attack and speed of the user by 1 stage each. This means that if a Pokemon at neutral stats uses the move, it will have 50% more attack and 50% more speed. After 2 uses, the user will have 2 times its original attack and speed. The craziest move on this list, effect-wise, is Triple Arrows and 9100 Fighting Physical move. This is Hisuian Decidueye's signature move, and has 3 different effects, one for each arrow. First, it has a high critical hit ratio, meaning it will land a critical hit 1/8 of the time rather than 1/24. Critical hits deal 1.5 times the damage as a normal hit, and ignore the user's stat drops along with the opponent's stat buffs. Second, it has a 50% chance to drop the target's defense by 1 stage. Third, it has a 30% chance to flinch and waste the target's turn, assuming Triple Arrows went off before the target's attack. Fighting type moves are great coverage as they hit 5 different types super effectively. However, 6 other types resist or are immune to these attacks, meaning they're not really spammable. Gen 9 released a move that is basically Dragon Dance on steroids, Rodent Dance. I wish it was called that, but we were given Tidy Up. Tidy Up clears all substitutes or hazards on either side of the field, in addition to raising the user's attack and speed by 1 stage each. Hazards are not that common in the VGC metagame, since switching is less frequent in 4v4 battles. Use cases for this extra effect are rare, but still exist. The ability Toxic Debris was released during the same generation, and sets toxic spikes on the other side of the field when physical contact is made. If Tidy Up is used, these spikes would disappear. Torch Song is the fire-type signature attack of Skeledirge, and is one of the weaker attacks in the game with a base power of 80. Every time it's used successfully, the user's special attack goes up by 1 stage. So after 2 uses, it's basically like you got up a free Nasty Plot along with 2 attacks. Number 72 is Shell Smash. This move raises the user's attack, special attack, and speed by 2 stages, while lowering defense and special defense by 1 stage. So when a Pokemon without any stat changes uses this move, it'll have double the attack, special attack, and speed, while having 2/3 of its original defense and special defense. This move sounds incredible, but dropping defenses while burning a turn to use this move isn't the safest plan, especially in doubles. There are some solutions to this, like giving your Pokemon a White Herb, a one-time use item that can remove the stat drops after Shell Smash is used. However, the White Herb can still be activated early by someone switching in a Pokemon with Intimidate, so even that's not always safe. Introduced in Pokemon Black and White, Shift Gear is a move that raises the user's attack by 1 stage and speed by 2. Basically Dragon Dance with one more speed boost. Not much else to say about this move, it's just a great stat booster with no drawbacks. Scald is a water type 8100 special move. While it isn't that strong, it can burn the opponent at a 30% clip, like Searing Shot. While I already stated that Searing Shot is tough to use because it targets your partner as well, there's another reason as to why Scald is way higher on the list. There's only one type in the game that's immune to getting burned, Fire. Because Fire types also resist fire attacks, they are usually safe switch-ins into fire moves that can burn. However, Scald is super effective into fire types. Ignoring opposing abilities, you almost always have a chance of getting something when you use a Scald. A burn, or a super effective hit. Mewtwo picked up a signature move 4 generations after it was released, getting Psy Strike in Black and White. It's a 100-100 psychic type special attack, but deals damage based on an opponent's defense rather than special defense. This allows a Pokemon to attack a target in 2 different ways depending on which of the target's defenses are lower. Psychic moves can be clicked pretty liberally since they hit 15 types for neutral or better damage. Technically not a signature move anymore, Tail Glow is the boosted form of Nasty Plot. It increases special attack by 3 stages rather than 2. That means a Pokemon at neutral stats will be 2.5 times stronger on the special side after using this once, and 4 times stronger after using it twice. Just one use of this move can give a Pokemon the power it needs to sweep through an entire team. The other premier form of speed control in doubles is Tailwind. Tailwind doubles your team's speed for 4 turns, including the turn it's used. Unlike Trick Room, however, Tailwind has normal priority and can be used at the beginning of the turn, allowing your other Pokemon to gain the speed boost immediately. So making use of all 4 turns is still possible. Tailwind goes great with powerful Pokemon in middling speed tiers that aren't slow enough to be used in Trick Room, but are usually too slow to be used without any speed control at all. I place Trick Room lower than Tailwind because it can usually be checked by having a slow Pokemon of your own, while you would need a ridiculously fast Pokemon to consistently outspeed an opponent's Pokemon in Tailwind. Going back to Pokemon Sun and Moon, Moongeist Beam is Lunala's signature move. It's a Ghost-type special 100-100 move, with the same ability-ignoring effect as Photon Geyser. Ghost is one of the best types offensively, hitting 14 types neutrally and 2 super effectively. Only normal types are immune, and only dark types are resistant. The Pikachu line got a signature move in Generation 3, Volt Tackle. It's an electric-type physical move, with the same numbers and effect as Woodhammer. 120 base power, 100% accuracy, and 1/3 of the damage dealt to the target hits the user as recoil. Volt Tackle also has an additional effect, a 10% chance to paralyze the target. Electric is decent offensively, hitting 2 types super effectively and 12 more neutrally. 3 types resist and ground types are immune. This next move is something that was discussed as being in contention for the most broken move of all time around the release of Scarlet and Violet, but didn't completely live up to that expectation. This move is Revival Blessing, a status move that revives one of your fainted Pokemon to up to half of its total HP. Even though it only has 1 power point, meaning it can only be used 1 time, just 1 use is enough to completely change the outcome of a battle. It's a little harder to use in doubles than singles, since the user can be doubled up by 2 Pokemon and faint before even using the move. Number 63 is Hyperspace Fury, Hoopa Unbound's signature move. It's a 100 base power physical dark type move that bypasses accuracy checks to always hit, like moves such as Aerial Ace and Aura Sphere. Another thing it bypasses is an opponent's protection move, though it lowers the user's defense. Protection moves are really common in doubles, as you can see from the teams of the finalists in the World Championships this year. An attack that breaks through Protect and also lifts the effects of Protect for the turn is a huge deal since your other Pokemon can attack the same slot afterwards. This move can severely restrict an opponent's options in a given turn. Ursaluna, a Pokemon introduced in Legends Arceus, got a new form in the Teal Mask, the first Scarlet and Violet DLC. This form is named Ursaluna Blood Moon, and its signature move is Blood Moon. This move is a 140 base power, 100% accurate normal type special move, with no drawbacks on the turn it is used. However, it cannot be used on the next turn. The problem with this is that if an opponent protects on a use of Blood Moon, you'll have to wait 2 turns before using it again. Charapagos is the newest legendary Pokemon, and possibly the most complicated one of all time. I won't get too much into specifics, but it has 3 different forms, one of which has a real stat spread but never actually battles. Being the poster child of the new Terastalization mechanic, its signature move is the aptly named Terra Starstorm. This is a 120 base power, 100% accurate normal type special move that starts out as a single target attack. However, it becomes a dual target attack when Terapagos Terastalizes, making it 90 BP into each slot due to the 75% spread modifier. Unfortunately, by my criteria, I can't take Terastalization into account, so it's just a 120-100 single target move. If I was, it would have been around 30 spots higher. Technoblast is the signature move of Genesect and starts out as a normal 120-100 special move like Terra Starstorm. Depending on the type of drive that Genesect is holding, Technoblast can also be an electric, fire, ice, or water type move, which poses a problem since your item slot would be wasted. Even in the case where the user isn't holding a drive, where Technoblast is a normal type move, a 120 base power move with no drawbacks is nothing to scoff at. As with a few moves before, the normal typing isn't that great though. Like Blood Moon, the next 2 moves were also introduced in the first Gen 9 DLC. Ogrepan's signature move is Ivy Cudgel, a physical 100-100 move that has a high critical hit ratio, meaning crits usually occur 3 times as often when using this move. By default, it's grass type, which is pretty underwhelming. However, depending on the mass that Ogrepan holds, it can be rock, fire, or water type as well. The reason why this move is higher than Technoblast even with a weaker base power is because the masks that change Ivy Cudgel's typing actually do something, giving a 20% damage boost to all of the holder's attacks. Again, the drives that change Technoblast's typing have no other effect. The second of the two moves is Macha Gacha, Sinistra's signature move. This move is a dual target, 80 base power grass type special move with only 90% accuracy. It has a 20% chance to burn any target it hits, which already makes it a good move. However, the second effect is what really makes it broken. It gains HP equal to 50% of the damage dealt to both targets. Considering that it's basically a 60 base power move into two targets, that's a lot of health. The box legendary of Pokemon Violet is Maridon, which possesses the signature special move Electro Drift. It's only a 100-100 move, but hits about 33% stronger when it's super effective. Unfortunately, electric attacks only hit 2 out of the 18 types super effectively, water and flying, thus limiting this move's potential. Sticking with electric moves, Zekrom's best signature move is Bolt Strike. Bolt Strike is a physical 130-85 electric move, with a 20% chance to paralyze the target. Like several moves before this, the only thing holding this move back is the accuracy. A 20% chance to paralyze is also definitely not negligible. Paralysis halves a Pokemon's speed and gives it a 25% chance to not make a move during each turn. U-turn is the next pivot move on the list, and a 70 base power physical bug move. Surprisingly, the bug typing is actually what makes this move so good. Unlike with other good pivot moves, there are absolutely no immunities or drawbacks to this move. U-turn can hit every type in the game and every ability in the game. For transparency, I've been pretending Wonder Guard is not an ability this entire video because it makes everything easier to explain. Anyways, this means that U-turn will always let you switch out without fail. If the opponent switches their Pokemon out as you use U-turn, or any pivot move for that matter, you gain momentum and can position to your liking. Number 54 is another pivot move, Parting Shot. This is a status move that lowers a target's attack and special attack by 1 stage each before allowing the user to switch out. As mentioned earlier, pivot moves increase a trainer's ability to maneuver the board into a positive state. No specific type of Pokemon is actually immune to Parting Shot, but some abilities can still stop it, like Clear Body, which ignores stat drops. Despite this hindrance, weakening an opponent's attack power before sending in your next Pokemon can make the switch a lot safer than it would be with U-turn or Volt Switch. Glaive Rush is Vexcalibur's 120-100 physical Dragon-type move. The drawback is that until the user uses a second move, all attacks going into the user will deal double the damage, and never miss. Any priority move or protect will end this period of vulnerability though. Ideally, you want to be using this move when you know you'll be picking up a KO. This move is also not winning any Best Animation Awards. Extreme Speed is an 80 base power physical move with a unique effect. It's in the priority bracket of +2, making it even faster than normal priority moves like Quick Attack or Aqua Jet. In other words, this move is almost always going first. 80 is still solid power for a move with such an advantageous effect, though the normal typing still isn't great. If I was accounting for the ability of Pokemon to terastalize into a different type, this move would be significantly higher in the list. The final signature move of Zygarde on this list is Thousand Arrows. It's only a 90 base power dual target attack like Thousand Waves, but it affects flying types and levitators. Not only that, but it knocks these Pokemon to the ground and potentially causes them to be weak to the next Thousand Arrows. For example, let's say Zapdos, an electric flying type Pokemon, gets hit by the first Thousand Arrows. It gets knocked down and loses its flying type. The next Thousand Arrows will be super effective since Zapdos is now a pure electric type. The ground type is already incredible offensively, and removing flying's immunity just takes it over the top. Starting off the top 50 is a move I had a tough time ranking. Geomancy is the signature move of Xerneas. It's a status move that sharply raises special attack, special defense, and speed by 2 stages each. Sounds incredible, right? The only problem is the move takes 2 turns to work, kind of like Sky Attack or Solar Beam. This means that the user becomes a sitting duck for a turn unless you give it a power herb. The power herb is a single-use item that removes the charge phase of a 2-turn move, which in Geomancy's case, allows the user to gain 6 stat increases in 1 turn. However, if the user loses the item before using it, it will actually be a sitting duck and fodder for any strong physical attacks. You only get 1 shot per battle to use this move, and if you click it at the wrong time, you're probably losing the game. Cinderace's Pyro Ball is a Fire-type 120-90 physical attack with a 10% chance to burn the target. No drawbacks, relatively high accuracy, and a strong but generally negligible secondary effect. Fire-type attacks are great offensively, hitting 4 types super effectively. The best signature move of any starter in my opinion is Masquerada's Flower Trick. This move is a grass-type physical move that never misses, but only has a base power of 70. However, it always lands in a critical hit, so its effective base power is 105. Critical hits ignore a user's attack drops and an opponent's defense boosts, while also going through defense boosting screens like Reflect and Aurora Veil. Like several moves before this one, Grass being pretty bad offensively holds Flower Trick back from being any higher. Bear with me on the explanation for this next move, or Mouse Width. Population Bomb, Mousehold's signature move, is a 20 base power physical normal type attack. Well, that's a little disingenuous since it's actually 200 if it hits all 10 times. That's unlikely though, since each hit is 90% accurate, and the move stops when one of them misses. The chance that all 10 hit is only about 35%. When the user is holding a wide lens, however, each hit becomes 99% accurate, setting the overall 10 hit chance to about 90%. Functionally, at the cost of a burned item slot, you have a 90% accurate 200 base power normal type move that can break through items such as Focus Sashes and abilities like Sturdy, that would normally activate only if the target Pokemon were to lose all its HP in one hit. Due to effectively item locking the user, Population Bomb is kinda like Geomancy. Next up is the water type version of Wood Hammer and Volt Tackle, Wave Crash. As a refresher, these are 120 base power, 100% accurate moves that cause the user to take 1/3 of the damage dealt in recoil. Water's a slightly better offensive type than electric, so the move lines here. Rock, ground, and fire types are weak to water attacks, while grass, dragon, and other water types resist them. The biggest holdup with placing Wave Crash any higher is that numerous relatively common abilities exist that immunize Pokemon against water moves, like Water Absorb, Storm Drain, and Dry Skin. The counterpart to Zekrom's Bolt Strike is Reshiram's Blue Flare. It's a fire type 130-85 special attack with a 20% chance to burn the target. While the accuracy is a bit lower than Pyroball a few spots above, Blue Flare is stronger and has a more relevant effect, with a 10% higher chance to burn. Next is another 120-100 recoil move, Flare Blitz. In addition to the 1/3 recoil effect, it can cause a burn 10% of the time. Even with the lack of longevity promoted by heavy recoil damage, I still think that the 100% accuracy justifies this move being placed ahead of Pyroball and its 90% accuracy. You always know what you're getting with Flare Blitz. It is worth noting that Pyroball would still typically be better on a Pokemon with a low HP stat, since you'd get to use it a few more times. The last big recoil move I want to talk about is Brave Bird. It's flying type and physical, with no other secondary effect. Flying only has 3 resistances and no immunities through type or ability, making Brave Bird the most spammable one of the 120 base power recoil moves. I had a hard time choosing between Flare Blitz and this, since fire type attacks hit 4 types super effectively, including Steel. Steel is the most important type to hit neutrally or super effectively, as it has a whopping 11 resistances or immunities. The 4 types that resist fire along with a couple abilities that are immune convince me to place it a spot below Brave Bird though. In general, with very strong attacks in the 100 BP and higher range, single target wise, the gap of importance between super effective and neutral damage narrows, while the gap between neutral and resisted damage widens, as does the gap between resisted and, well, no damage. You want to be knocking out as many Pokemon as possible, and the stronger a move gets, the more likely it is that neutral damage will be sufficient to pick up a knockout. Number 42 is Groudon's signature move, Precipice Blades. This is a ground-type physical 120-85 move that can hit both opposing Pokemon. The accuracy is a little annoying, but the top-notch coverage of ground moves makes Precipice Blades very useful in doubles. Strength Sap is the final recovery move on the list. It heals HP equal to the opponent's attack stat number and lowers their attack by 1 stage. If this move is used against any physical attacker, it'll likely recover upwards of 75% of the user's HP. While every subsequent use will award less HP, the opponent will also be doing less damage unless they switch out, in which case you'll be drinking from a neutral attack stat again. As long as there isn't an opposing Pokemon on the field with a strong setup move like Swords Dance, which boosts attack faster than Strength Sap would lower it, this move can be clicked freely. The best pivot move in the game is Shed Tail, introduced in Gen 9. For some background info on how this move works, I need to describe Substitute, a move that sets up a substitute using 25% of the user's HP. The substitute has that 25% HP, along with the defense and special defense stats of the user. The Pokemon possessing the sub is immune to most form of damage and status effects until it breaks. Now imagine setting one up, but being able to switch out on the same turn, passing the sub to your next Pokemon. That's what Shed Tail does, though it uses up 50% of the user's HP rather than 25% to keep the move from being incredibly broken. If you're able to use this move successfully, you can nearly guarantee a turn for your incoming Pokemon to attack or set up freely. Sacrificing 50% of your health is much harder to do in doubles than singles, not to mention that substitutes are just easier to break when being faced down by 2 Pokemon rather than 1. That's why Shed Tail is banned in singles and just number 40 on this list. Numbers 39 and 38 are Victory Dance and Quiver Dance, respectively. The former is the signature move of Hisuian Lilligant, and the latter is one of the only saving graces for bug types. Victory Dance boosts the user's attack, defense, and speed by 1 stage each, while Quiver Dance does the same for special attack, special defense, and speed as well. Either move awards 3 potentially useful stat gains with just 1 use. I placed Quiver Dance higher since there are more ways to lower a Pokemon's attack than special attack. Just 2 all-around impressive status moves. The counterpart to Muraidon's Electro Drift is Kuraidon's Collision Course, a fighting-type 100-100 physical move. As a reminder, these moves deal around 33% more damage when super effective, which is appreciably more relevant for fighting-type attacks than electric. Five different types are weak to fighting attacks, maximizing Collision Course's effect. Knockoff is a 65 base power physical dark-type move. It does exactly what it sounds like it does, knocks off the target's item. If the target is indeed holding an item, this move will be 50% stronger. Items are some of the most important elements of competitive Pokémon, with nearly every Pokémon holding one. Different items help a Pokémon fulfill different roles. For example, giving the leftovers to stall Pokémon like Ferrothorn and Toxapex lets them regain 1/16th of their HP at the end of each turn, helping them stay on the field longer. If their items get knocked off, they can be dealt with more easily. Knocking off a Pokémon's Life Orb or Choice Specs reduces damage output. And, in the example with Xerneas and Geomancy earlier, if you knock off the Xerneas' Power Herb before it uses Geomancy, it's gonna take two turns, leaving it a sitting duck. If you think an opponent is switching Pokémon, you can simply have one of your Pokémon click knockoff into that slot if available, and you'll pretty much always have a positive turn. It's one of the weaker attacks remaining damage-wise, but still fantastic thanks to its unique effect. Next is another flying-type move, Yveltal's Oblivion Wing. Yeah, that's right, I put Yveltal's move higher than Xerneas's. Oblivion Wing is an 80 base power special flying move that heals the user by some of the HP dealt. There are a lot of 80-ish base power moves with that effect that miss the list, like Giga Drain, Horn Leech, Leech Life, and Drain Punch. So why is Oblivion Wing so high up? The answer is the difference between the amount of HP healed. While the four moves I just listed heal the user by 50% of the HP dealt, Oblivion Wing heals the user by 75% of the HP dealt. That's a decent attack and potentially a full recovery all in one move. Number 34 is a move I guarantee 95% of you weren't expecting to see on the list. I'm talking about Beak Blast, Duchannon's signature move from Pokémon Sun and Moon. Beak Blast is a 100-100 physical flying move with decreased priority. It charges up at the very beginning of the turn and fires at the end of it. So why would a move that almost always goes last be good? All opposing Pokémon that target the charging user with a contact move will be burned. Bulky Pokémon that just sit on the field can use this move to great effect. These Pokémon are usually slow anyways, so moving last wouldn't really matter. Duchannon's terrible bulk prevents the move from being more popular, not the move itself. The second strongest move by base power on this list is Tinkaton's Gigaton Hammer. It's a 160 base power physical steel type attack, but cannot be used twice in a row, like Ursaluna's Blood Moon, even if it hits into a Protect. Unlike Blood Moon though, Gigaton Hammer is 20 base power higher, explaining why it's further up on the list. Numbers 32 and 31 are two moves which have no use outside of doubles, Rage Powder, and Follow Me, respectively. These moves redirect all opposing attacks towards the user. If you have one Pokémon use this move, then your other Pokémon can potentially set up stat boosts, safely get up Trick Room, or use powerful attacks. Follow Me is better than Rage Powder because Rage Powder can be ignored by grass types, Pokémon with the ability Overcoat, or Pokémon holding the safety goggles. There's only one move potentially better than Shedtail in singles, and that's Last Respects, a ghost-type physical move that starts out as a 50-100 attack. However, for each Pokémon that faints from the user's party, this move's power increases by 50. So if 5 allies faint in a single battle, this move's power would be 300. In VGC doubles, only 4 Pokémon can be used, but a maxed out power of 200 is still nothing to scoff at. Only problem is, you might be facing 2 Pokémon at a time rather than 1, preventing you from using the higher base power versions of this move often. In other words, this move has a really high ceiling, but a really low floor. Not to mention, the opponent is the one who controls the move's power for the most part. A fun fact about Last Respects is that it got one of the least broken Pokémon in existence banned in singles. Only 2 Pokémon get this move, Basculegion and Houndstone. Basculegion wasn't legal at the beginning of Scarlet and Violet, leaving just Houndstone. Since Smogon doesn't ban moves that only have one user, they banned poor old Houndstone instead. Another move that often ends with a burn is Sacred Fire, a 100 BP, 95% accurate move that can inflict a burn 50% of the time. Well, the accuracy makes that 47.5%, but who cares? Inflicting burns that both have a target's attack and inflict chip damage every turn can be game-breaking if they're occurring every 2 uses of Sacred Fire, especially when the opponent can only use 4 Pokémon total during a battle. Close Combat is a physical, fighting-type 120-100 move. Its drawback is different from some of the previous 120 base power moves I've discussed, though. Rather than causing recoil damage, it lowers defense and special defense by 1 stage. So while it's harder for a Pokémon continuously using this move to safely stay on the field, you can easily remove these drops by switching out. In other words, the drawback isn't permanent. The fighting moves are resisted or completely neutered by 6 different types, they're super effective against 5, including the ever so important Steel. Close Combat is probably the best coverage move in the game that more than 5 Pokémon actually have access to. Volcanion's Steam Eruption is a super powered Scald. It's a water type special move with a 30% chance to burn. The only differences between the two moves is that the base power and accuracy of Steam Eruption are 30 points higher and 5% lower than Scald. Scald can be used more often due to a higher power point total, but the base power difference is still too stark, and PP isn't as much of a factor in doubles than singles. As I explained earlier, a water type move with a high chance to burn is really good since the only type that is immune to being burned, fire, is weak to the move itself. Scarlet and Violet introduced a Pokemon based on Rock Salt, fittingly named Garganacle. Its signature move is Salt Cure, a Rock-type physical attack with a base power of 40. This move inflicts any Pokemon it hits with a Salt Cure. Any Pokemon afflicted with this status effect loses 1/8 of its health per turn until it switches out, unless it is Water or Steel type, in which case it would lose 1/4. No specific type of Pokemon is immune to Salt Cure, though some abilities and items can stop the effect. Salt Cure is a valuable move in 4-on-4 doubles since it's great at forcing and punishing switches. Fake Out is one of the most essential moves for teams in doubles. This normal type physical move can only be used on the first turn that the user is out in battle, though this condition resets if the user switches out and back in. It has a base power of just 40, but one massive effect. It always flinches its target. This effect can stop opposing game plans right in their tracks, or enable your own. Let's say you want to set up Trick Room with a Pokemon, but your opponent has one non-ghost type Pokemon that can KO your Trick Room setter. You can simply fake it out with your partner while letting the opponent's less threatening Pokemon attack. And that's probably a free Trick Room. You can also cycle through Pokemon with Fake Out to put yourself in a better board position. Take a look at this scenario. If your opponent thinks you're going to fake out their target, they're highly likely to either protect it for the turn, or switch out into a Pokemon that can deal with the user's side of the field. To take advantage of this, you can switch into another Fake Out user, letting you fake them out the next turn. It's a move with a very high skill ceiling. No coincidence that 6 of the last 7 world champions have had a Fake Out user on their teams. Starting off the top 24 are 3 100% accurate special attacks that all do the same thing. Water Spout, Eruption, and Dragon Energy are Water, Fire, and Dragon-type moves, respectively. They start off at a base power of 150 and deal dual target damage. While that sounds great, they get weaker the less HP the user has. An easy way to calculate the current base power is multiplying the percent of HP the user has remaining by 1.5. At 50% health, it'll be a 75 base power move, half the original power. The damage will only be significant for about the first 40-ish percent of the user's health, giving it a short shelf life. However, if the user is fast enough, which items like the Choice Scarf or moves like Tailwind can help with, these moves can sweep through entire teams in doubles. Honestly, they can probably be ranked in any order. As I mentioned when discussing Brave Bird versus Flare Blitz, the importance of neutral damage goes up when the base power of moves is high, since you have better chances to pick up KOs with neutral attacks. Fire hits 14 types for neutral or better damage, Water hits 15, and Dragon hits 16. However, Fire hits 4 types super effectively, Water hits 3, and Dragon hits only 1. It's a tough call, especially since the base power is not always the same. Numbers 21 and 20 belong to Detect and Protect. They are the most standard protection moves, as they protect the user from all attacks, including status ones. Some status moves that are intended to be used by a partner Pokemon go through though, like Coaching, Howl, and Decorate. Those are all stat boosters for the protecting Pokemon though. Protect has more power points than Detect, so I'm placing it a spot higher. Gouging Fire, the Paradox version of Entei, received the best signature move in either DLC. Burning Bulwark can block any attack that doesn't have a protection breaking effect for the turn. If an opponent makes contact with the Bulwark, they'll be burned, similarly to Beak Blast but without the damage. The only issue with this move is that status effects can still pass through. For example, the Burning Bulwark user can be taunted while using the move, preventing it from using it or any other status moves again for the next 3 turns. My next grouping covers numbers 18 and 17, Spiky Shield and Baneful Bunker, the latter of which is the signature move of Toxapex, everyone's favorite stall guy. These are objectively better protection moves than the previous 3 entries, since they block all attacks, in addition to having secondary effects. Contacting Pokemon get poisoned by Baneful Bunker and take an 1/8 of their health from Spiky Shield. I'd say Baneful Bunker is slightly better, since the poison status gets rid of 1/8 of the opponent's HP every turn, rather than just the turn the protection move was used, like in the case of Spiky Shield. The strongest move in the game that doesn't cause the user to faint is V-Create, Victini's other signature move. It's a fire-type physical attack that has an accuracy of 95% and a base power of 180. The drawback is massive though, lowering the user's defense, special defense, and speed by 1 stage. Because of the speed drop, you can't continuously use it like with close combat. But stat drops are temporary, as you can just switch out after using the move, then use it once again once you get your Pokemon back in safely. A 180 base power move that can hit any Pokemon besides ones with the ability Splash Fire and, well, Baked Body is incredibly devastating.
Number 15, Armor Cannon. The last thing you want burning your Burger King burger is another Pokemon's Armor Cannon.
This is the signature move of Armorouge, Cerulege's counterpart. It's a 120-100 special move that drops defense and special defense by 1 stage, like close combat. Good old strong fire-type damage with a reversible drawback. Rayquaza's signature move, Dragon Ascent, is a flying-type physical attack. I know it's named Dragon Ascent, but it's flying type. 120-100, lowers defense and special defense by one stage, and hits 15 types for neutral or better damage. Like when I place Flare Blitz below Brave Bird, the fire type immune abilities and higher number of resistances are why Armor Cannon is a spot below Dragon Ascent. A new move introduced in Legends Arceus was Headlong Rush, the ground type physical version of the previous two moves. As mentioned earlier, ground is one of the best offensive types in the game, hitting 5 others super effectively, including Steel and Fire, the two types with the most resistances. Only two types resist ground attacks, one of them being the worst type in the game, Bug. Flying types and Pokemon with the ability Levitate are immune, but ground's remarkable offensive profile more than covers for that weakness in its game. A new Pokemon introduced in the Isle of Armor DLC was Urshifu. It received two forms, known as Rapid Strike and Single Strike Urshifu, each of which received a signature move. Single Strike Urshifu can use Wicked Blow, a Dark-type 7500 physical move that always lands in a critical hit, similar to Flower Trick. Rapid Strike can use Surging Strikes, which is basically a Water-type Wicked Blow, broken up into 325 base power hits. Since crits do 1.5 times the damage, the effective base power of both moves is 112.5, and critical hits ignore opposing defense boosts along with user attack drops. I'm putting Surging Strikes one spot higher than Wicked Blow for one simple reason. Surging Strikes can break through Pokemon that have the ability Sturdy or hold Focus Sashes due to hitting 3 times, while Wicked Blow cannot. In Generation 8, I would have switched the order since Wicked Blow used to be 80 base power instead of 75. Before entering the top 10, I'd like to give several honorable mentions. First are the 100 base power moves with high critical hit ratios like Lugia's Aeroblast, Palkia's Spatial Rend, and the Crustaceans' Crabhammer. If they were 100% accurate, they would have made it. Next are the moves that always heal 50% or more, with no drawbacks. Slack Off, Heal Order, Soft Boiled, Recover, Milk Drink, and Shore Up. These moves are some of the casualties of ignoring single battles. Shore Up, the signature move of Palisand, is the only one of these 6 moves that can heal more than 1/2 of the user's total HP, healing 2/3 in a sandstorm. Speaking of single battles, I'd be remiss to not mention any of the hazard and hazard removal moves. Spikes, Ceaseless Edge, Toxic Spikes, Sticky Web, Stealth Rock, Stone Axe, Defog, and Rapid Spin. Ceaseless Edge and Stone Axe are new attacking moves that also set up Spikes and Stealth Rocks, respectively. Stealth Rock is legitimately a top 5 move in singles, but is pretty irrelevant when the occurrence of switching is relatively limited, like in VGC doubles or playthroughs for that matter. Now we have the 130 to 140 base power and 90% accurate moves that drop the user's special attack by 2 stages. These are Overheat, Leaf Storm, Floor Cannon, Draco Meteor, and Psycho Boost. If a Pokemon uses this move into a resisting target, it will be forced to switch out on the following turn most of the time due to its halved special attack. Reshiram's Fusion Flare and Zekrom's Fusion Bolt are 200-100 moves that have no extra effect except doubling in power when the other is used. So no extra effect 99.9% of the time. Solgaleo's Sunsteel Strike and Iron Crown's Tachyon Cutter are two casualties of possessing the Steel typing without a strong enough secondary effect to cover for it. Steel is super effective against 3 types and resisted by 4, including Fire, Water, and Steel itself. Sunsteel Strike is a 100-100 physical move that has the same effect as Lunala's Moongeist Beam and Necrozma's Photon Geyser, ignoring opposing abilities. Tachyon Cutter is marked as a 50-100 special move, but hits 2 times, giving it the ability to break Focus Sashes and Sturdy. With the honorable mentions out of the way, it's time to start the top 10. Number 10. Make It Rain. Goldengo's signature move is a Steel-type 120-100 dual target attack that drops the user's special attack by 1 stage after each use. You might recall me placing the Draco Meteor-like attacks that drop special attack in the honorable mentions. While those 5 moves were all marginally stronger, they were also single target attacks, 10% less accurate, and more damaging to the user's special attack, lowering it by 2 stages instead of 1. So while the first use of this move will be really strong, the second will still pack a decent punch. And in some cases, the third. Number 9. Marshadow's Spectral Thief is a physical ghost-type move with a base power of 90 and an accuracy of 100%. This move steals only the positive stat changes of the target, then deals damage. For example, if there's an Excadrill with maxed out attack staring down your Pokemon, but you have a faster Mon with Spectral Thief, you can use it to steal the stat boosts and KO the Excadrill with your own maxed out attack. You can also take away a target's bulk boosting stats to both increase your bulk and make the opponent easier to knock out with your other Pokemon. I think this move would have been a bit more balanced if it also stole negative stat boosts, but Game Freak probably doesn't care since it's on a mythical Pokemon that isn't even legal in VGC. No mythical Pokemon have ever been legal in official in-person tournaments for that matter. Number 8. Diamond Storm. Diancie's signature move is a dual target 100 base power 95% accurate rock type physical move that has a 50% chance of raising the user's defense by 2 stages. Assuming neutral stats, the user will double its defense if the effect activates. Rock is a pretty good offensive type, hitting 4 types super effectively and 3 types not very effectively. The most important card that the rock type has, especially for this move, is that no type or ability can completely negate rock moves. That fact, to go along with a highly occurring powerful secondary effect, is why Diamond Storm lands in 8th place. Number 7, Rage Fist. Primate received an evolution in Scarlet and Violet, a ghost fighting Pokemon named Annihilape. The way it evolves is by using Rage Fist 20 times and leveling up. In other words, it gets so mad that it dies. Rage Fist, like Last Respects, starts out as a 50 base power ghost type physical attack. However, for each hit that the user takes, the power rises by 50. The simple existence of the move Beat Up makes the power of Rage Fist really easy to manipulate. Beat Up is a weak 10 base power attack that hits one time for each Pokemon in your party that is alive and not suffering from a status effect. That's potentially 4 hits right off the bat in a VGC match, potentially making this move a 250 base power attack in one turn. Even better, if you have to switch the user out for whatever reason, the power boosts still remain. That guy remembers. Items like Leftovers or Citrus Berries can increase the user's longevity, allowing for more uses of Rage Fist during the battle. There's a lot of setup involved with this move, but the payout is insanely high. Number 6, Astral Barrage. There's a massive jump between 7 and 6 on this list. This is a Sword and Shield DLC signature move used by Calyrex Shadow Rider, which is just Calyrex riding a Spectrier. It's a 120-100 Ghost-type special move with no drawbacks. You already know that Ghost-type attacks are only bad against Dark and Normal types, hitting the 16 others for at least neutral damage. Everything I've just said is enough to have carried Astral Barrage into the top 10, but it gets even better. This is a dual target move. Game Freak should have balanced it like Groudon and Kyogre's signature moves, which are both 85%. But that just doesn't happen anymore, does it? Number 5, Glacial Lance. Yup, it's the move of the other horse, Calyrex Ice Rider, which is a Calyrex riding a Glastrier. Glacial Lance is an Ice-type physical 130-100 dual target move. While I think physical moves are slightly worse than special ones due to prevalent abilities like Intimidate, the extra 10 base power and great coverage of Ice-type moves makes Glacial Lance better than Astral Barrage in my opinion. Here's something surprising. Even with Ice's positive offensive profile, Glacial Lance is the only representative on the entire list. Number 4. Spore. Spore is a 2008 life simulation real-time strategy game. It is also the name of the greatest sleep-inducing move in Pokemon. Sleep is a debilitating status effect that causes the opponent to do nothing for 1-3 turns. Recently, they actually removed this clause from the Premier Singles format, OU, only to outright ban sleep instead. There's no sleep restrictions in VGC though. To understand how broken Spore is, let's look at some of the other sleep-inducing moves first. Singing Grass Whistle, 55% accurate. Hypnosis, 60%. 70% in Diamond and Pearl for some reason, but Game Freak changed it back to 60% in Platinum since it was presumably too broken. Sleep Powder, 75%. Iffy territory, but sure. And then there's Spore. 100% accurate. Good night. Spore was one of the very first moves to be balanced by distribution. Four Mushroom lines, all of which are either very slow or have reduced priority on their status moves, get this move. Technically, Smeargle, which can learn basically every move, also gets Spore, but can be KO'd very easily due to its low bulk and middling speed. Speaking of Smeargle and Sleep, I should probably also quickly mention Dark Void, Darkrai's signature move. Dark Void is a dual target sleep move that used to be 80% accurate until Gen 7, meaning it had a 64% chance to put both opponents to sleep. Darkrai wasn't legal in VGC, but Smeargle was. It ran rampant in 2016, even amongst all the legendaries. In Gen 7, Game Freak made Dark Void 50% accurate and took the move away from Smeargle. Number 3, Boltbeak. Boltbeak is the signature move of the fossilized bird Pokemon Arctozolt and Dracozolt. It's a physical 85 base power 100% accurate electric type attack. If the user moves before the opposing Pokemon or the target switches out, this move will double in strength, increasing the power to an effective 170. Just think about it this way. If an opponent switches a supposedly resistant grass type into Boltbeak, it basically turns into a neutral 85 base power move. That doesn't sound like a resistance to me. The condition of needing to go first can easily be checked off through things like setting up Tailwind or giving the user a Choice Scarf, which multiplies the user's speed by 1.5 times at the cost of locking it into one move. Number 2. Fissious Rend. The other fossil signature move belongs to Arctovish and the infamous Dracovish. Fissious Rend is just Boltbeak, but Water-type. It's above Boltbeak for the sole reason that there are less immunities to Water-type moves than Electric-type moves. I think you can notice a trend here, as 6 out of the last 11 moves on this list have been from Generation 8. Wicked Blow, Surging Strikes, Astral Barrage, Glacial Lance, Boltbeak, and Fissious Rend. There was almost no balancing going on that generation. Anyways, thank you Mr. Fish, but what move could possibly top this? Number 1. Double Iron Bash. Melmetal's signature move is a steel-type physical attack composed of two separate hits, each with a base power of 60 and accuracy of 100. So basically a 120 base power attack that can break through focus sashes and Pokemon with Sturdy. You have already seen several more powerful attacks, some of which were dual target, that were better than double Iron Bash, type-wise. So what makes it the best move in Pokemon? As I'm sure you've guessed, it's the effect. Each of the two hits has a 30% chance to flinch, independently. So for a target to not flinch to this move, it either has to move first, or pass through two 70% checks to not flinch, meaning that if double Iron Bash goes first, it will flinch 51% of the time. That means the target would be more likely to flinch than to not flinch. I know I spent the end of the honorable mentions section bashing the steel type, but it's actually really good here. No type of Pokemon is actually immune to steel, so save for ones with a certain couple of abilities or items, every single Pokemon can be flinched by this move. Double Iron Bash is similar to Fish's Rend and Bolt Beak, in that to get the max amount of value out of the move, it needs to go first. That's probably why Game Freak was comfortable giving this move to Melmetal, which has a base speed of 34. Slower than Kakuna. And that's the list. Remember to like and subscribe if you enjoyed the video, and leave a comment for the algorithm. If there's any move you think I missed or misplaced, let me know. Thanks for watching.